1, 2, 3.
So you are now the queen of the party circuit.
Yes. I would love to.
Have you spent time in Hollywood before? I mean, you don't have a number of Hollywood movies on your resume.
But... No, but actually I've been coming here since 8 years, and I was totally in love with the city, with your cinema.
Huh.
And yeah, I've been coming, you know, many times, it's many years, and then meeting people day after day,
right.
Like Mike Medavoy, or good people that were
right.
really supportive to my work, and you know, I got really lucky. I did Modigliani with Andy Garcia.
Right.
The movie didn't do well, but I got such a great part for me. It was amazing to do that. And then this movie, which is amazing. And
well, it's interesting looking at your resume. It seems like you've played a lot of muses over the years. I saw that you actually got award stuff from the beginning for playing
yeah.
a prostitute
exactly.
to Van Gogh before
yeah.
he passed away. Is that just... Were you typed from that when you were a young, starting out actress, or?
No, but actually it's Hazard, you know. On Van Gogh, the movie was made by Maurice Pialat, which is an amazing director,
uh-huh.
who died now, which was considered the best director in France, and he got 2 Palme d'Ors, and he's
right.
an amazing director. Actually, I was, you know, I played the whore in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
It was a supporting part, and I got a Caesar nomination, and all my career began like this.
Yeah.
It may be because I'm changing faces very easily.
Mm-hmm.
I can be very classy, classic, and I love paintings, but it's just Hazard, and I did Modigliani, and Toulouse-Lautrec, and Van Gogh,
uh-huh.
and I got, and it's very beautiful. It's like a metaphor of being a muse for writers and directors,
mm-hmm.
in a way. It's,
sure.
so no, it was great. You know, as long as you have material, then great part.
So this part is very, for both of you, really.
Right.
I mean, you're both kind of glamour pusses in the classic Hollywood style, movie style.
Right.
And yet here you're both kind of down a notch, kind of both worn out from the work. Was that exciting to do, or do you do much of that otherwise? Do you dress down for being less glamorous?
No, I mean, when you get a part, who cares? I can change my hair, I can change my face, I can take some weight, I can change the... Of course, it's, for me, the game is that. It's
right.
Just getting into someone else's body and someone else's spirit. And
uh-huh.
When we did I've Loved You for So Long with Christine, the director really wanted us to be true, to see our souls, and to be close to our face. So I think
mm-hmm.
he wanted us to be very pure in one way.
Yeah.
And you know, it's funny because he cut my hair, I was wearing flat shoes, very casual things,
yeah.
and in a way it was a freedom every morning being filmed closely
mm-hmm.
with nothing that you could think of, not getting interested in your makeup or nothing,
uh-huh.
and we were just so involved in and committed in our parts, and
mm-hmm.
I think it's very rare. That's why I think the movie is universal.
Mm-hmm.
It's talking about secrets, about lies, about family secrets, and I think we really with the two hearts beating, and
mm-hmm.
we can see our soul and our, you know, there's something, the chemistry that works really wonderfully with Christine.
Well, there's something about these two beautiful sisters who both have that kind of look of despair on their face
yeah.
through almost the entire movie. It's like
yeah.
the weight that you feel the minute
yeah,
you meet both.
I think
them.
It was very important to fulfill yourself because in a way they're both in prison. For
yeah.
me, my character is very supple. It's, you know, at the beginning she welcomed her sister. I haven't seen her in 15 years,
mm-hmm.
but in a way, she's been in jail as well, you know, and then the more the movie's going, the more you discover how lost
right.
she was, how depending on her sister she was, and even her smiles at the beginning,
mm-hmm.
the cries behind,
yeah.
their sorrow and pain, and she's shaking from the inside, and
mm-hmm.
this character was very interesting to do,
mm-hmm.
because suddenly she's going back to being 15.
Mm.
Being scared, loving her, hating her.
Mm-hmm.
She is really like a young girl, and suddenly she's not a mother anymore. She's doing it, but she's like so scared and anxious,
yeah.
and she's guilty. That's part of my, you know, it was very
mm-hmm.
interesting to bring out some guilt. How
mm-hmm.
do you create miss and loss? You haven't seen someone for 15 years.
Right.
How do you create memories and make it real?
Mm-hmm.
You know, not having seen someone.
Mm.
It has to be there, and my character is fulfilled of she needs redemption, and she's fulfilled with guilt,
mm-hmm.
which is very interesting to play, and because she hasn't done what she should do,
right.
what she should have done, and then now it's too late, but
yeah.
they're trying to go back to 15 years before and to reconnect to each other and to discover each other again, like two animals.
Hmm.
They're two wild animals, I think.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know each other anymore.
Yeah.
They have, and they're trying
but
to
they
catch.
Do.
They do.
I mean, they
That's
do
why.
In such a profound way.
Exactly, in a profound way.
Yeah.
And they're trying to remember and to go back to what they went through and their lives. And to hooked and trying to bring back their memories.
Because it is like they both have been wearing this cloak of secrecy this entire time. One more happily than other, one in jail, one not.
Yeah.
But still, they're the only two that really know the truth of the other person.
Exactly. But they're carrying this heavy secrets and this heavy, you know, murder. Without my character, without knowing
right.
exactly what happened, when
yeah.
she discovered, without saying to the people, when she discovered what happened, she's like desperate. You know, in front of the doctor, when it happened
right.
to the doctor, and I'm realizing what I should do, should have,
mm-hmm.
I think she's almost fainting. Oh, heart,
mm-hmm.
I was shaking when I played it.
Mm-hmm.
I really wanted her to feel, oh, God. I should have do that, and she represents a society in a way.
Hmm.
When she said, I'm not the others, now you
right.
can talk to me, she's the others.
Mm-hmm.
She was the others. She was representing the society
right.
and this, the, you know, the relations you can have to prison.
Mm-hmm.
And all what, prison is always there in the movie. You
right.
don't see it, but it's there, you know.
Yeah.
What it feels, having been close to someone who was in jail for 15 years, how do you feel
mm-hmm.
feeling scared of not saying to anyone, I have my sister in jail,
mm-hmm.
and pretending that you have no sister. So that's what literally I did
yeah.
in the movie, and my character, you know, said, I'm the only child, that I have no sister.
Yeah.
So she had to lie. And it's all that, you know, in life what's interesting is, when you hide things,
yeah.
one day it's coming up. And it's really the moment everything is about to burst. And they're like here, both of them. They're like, you know, sorrow
right.
and pain is here. And it's about to burst.
Well, it can be almost anything. The other thing that's fascinating to
yeah.
me is that the universality of it is, you know, you don't have to be involved with a heinous crime or a sad crime. You can, you know, it's the small things in life too. When you carry them around as secrets.
Exactly.
They eat and they eat and they eat. And there's
exactly.
no, you know, you never can remember how to lie properly and keep the lie going. And
yeah.
Even when you're, you know, the truth. It's an odd thing.
Yeah, and sometimes you lie to yourself. When Christine's character is trying to tell me, do you remember when we went to the dance class? And suddenly I said, oh, God, I don't remember.
Yeah.
I forgot things because I need to.
Yeah.
You know, and even the mother has been in prison, forgetting things,
mm-hmm.
being Alzheimer's.
Well, it's safety.
Safety,
way,
exactly,
you know.
Right. Exactly.
You kind of wonder how much is Alzheimer's and how much is choice.
Exactly. No, you're totally right.
Yeah.
And it's terrible, and for people around, you know, yeah. And even, I think it's two sisters, it could be two brothers, that's what you say.
Yeah.
There's so much humanity in the film and in our two characters. And the relationship, and the director takes his time
mm-hmm.
telling the story of those two girls, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the time goes on. And what I love is the rhythm of the movie is perfect.
Right.
I mean, suddenly they speak about themselves and then go back to roots to cook, to do a cake or
right.
swim. And the souvenir coming back by doing very casual things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, connecting and doing things they were used to do when they were 15 or
mm-hmm.
10 or... And
right.
it's very beautiful. And
mm-hmm.
like in life, you don't say to someone right away, why have you done that? Mommy is... A... They just
right.
speak about, oh, your hair goes like, oh... You know, about
yeah.
sometimes you can't speak to someone. You have to go to the pool or to play tennis or
mm-hmm.
to cook a cake. So I think that's very truthful and sincere. And
those are the moments you forget your fears, I guess.
Exactly.
And just act like a normal person.
Yeah, and my director wanted me to be very sensitive and vulnerable the whole way. And
so when you get the script, so you take that script, do you... start breaking it down yourself? Do you work very closely with the director to discuss these kind of issues and what the subtext of everything is? Or who's in charge of that?
You know, I think it's different. Every director wants to work a different way. What I know is I have my own kitchen inside, that's for sure. I think it's very intimate to do a part, very intimate. It's linked to yourself, and you do it, and it's special because it's you, definitely. Then you don't do it with a without a director.
Right.
You know, you have to have an eye, someone who's looking at you, put the camera right way. I remember having done movies, sometimes you do an amazing scene, and you watch it and go,
yeah,
that's too far. We don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And then good directors I've worked with, you know, it's the perfect when you, for example, you're like this, and then there's a close up. I don't know, the way he's filming your eyes or your profile, just the way you bend your head, everything makes difference.
Yeah, I've reviewed movies and I've like talked about having the director is afraid to punch into a close up of the eyes, and that's where the whole story is. There's actually a movie out now, which I won't name because we're having a conversation, and they're all very nice people. But, you know, it's a movie that is about passion and fear and sexual intimacy and things like this. And you never see the face of the people having sex. And they have a number of sexual encounters during the movie. But you're like, that's where the story is. It's not that they're... It's not watching two people hump on a couch.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Interesting.
It's knowing what they're feeling while they're cheating on their wife or doing whatever they're doing.
You know, for me, it's very... I like to put myself... I'm not saying in danger because, you know, I'm not... doctor operating a heart, but for example, I watch DiCaprio in this movie Revolution Road. I like when actors are bringing their soul in their eyes. I like to feel like I can fall down. If I'm not feeling really bad when I do a scene, like I can't recover for an hour after, like really crushing and spitting my body, it needs to come up. If it's unbearable for me, it's good. If I feel really bad and I can't recover, it means something. If I feel still, okay, I can talk, I'm really someone who's diving into herself. If I'm not getting to this point, I can't, got moved, dang it. If I'm not getting to the point, that is not, sorry.
Okay.
Well.
You're having a Mickey Rourke moment. That's what you call them officially this year. When anybody cries on camera this year, it's Mickey Rourke moment.
Oh, really? Okay, sorry.
I don't mean to be teasing.
No, because I'm like
sorry.
Passionate and when I'm
no, it's done. Very intense. It's very, but it's real for you. Was it always that way as an actor? Did you start?
Yeah.
Is that why you became an actor? Is that...
I think so. I was very shy. So I don't know. Sorry, terrible. I was very shy. I don't know. I was a dancer. I was a very good dancer. I was very good on stage. I'm being shy. All my family, everybody was watching me doing this dance, and everybody said, wow, she's got so much charisma and she should do something. And I said, oh, well, no, I love dancing. I was so shy, I couldn't imagine saying some words. I couldn't. Everybody went to drama school doing theater except me. I couldn't. And one day I think I watched Isabella Gianni and I saw her and I thought, oh, God, she touches me. And I thought, oh, there's something, even without saying I want to be an actress, I was not a girl like, oh, hi, I'm an actor. Not at all. I was hiding things. I was not a big talker. I'm a group of girls. I would always say it was my mother, my father. Very, you know. And one day I just went to the drama school at 17 and I just introduced myself and it was it. I knew.
So did you...
I just said my name and I said, well, I was even scared to say my name. And I went back home and I said, this is my life. My dad said, well, we'll see. So I went to university for English. And I went back to school every day, drama school, 9 o'clock, right on time. I was a hard worker. I was doing 4 scenes a week. I was working very hard. And I knew. I never doubting what I'm doing. I never doubt I won't do it.
Do you remember a specific moment where you... Was it...
Yeah, I was in the Champs-Élysées with my book of pictures. You know, there were many more beautiful girls or different... I was not, you know, I was very... I didn't know, but I was very classic and I knew it was special. I don't know. It's terrible to say that. I knew you could... Any time I would take a part, it would be special because it was who I am. Why? I don't know, you know. I got this confidence inside. Not for my life. I couldn't kiss a man at 18. It was... rushing in the bathroom, had no confidence, but for my art, always. Yeah, and you know, maybe, yeah, on the Champs-Élysées with my book of pictures, going to see people. And maybe Maurice Pialat gave me the first director I worked with, but it was tough. It was really tough.
Mm-hmm.
What I learned from him is I never take things for granted. I always feel that I'm beginning. Always. Mm-hmm. I'm still beginning, of course, but
mm-hmm.
I've done 25 movies. And there's so much things I want to do, so much director I want to work with. There's still so many things. But in a way, what is great is I'm still young and I have all those parts on my shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel ready to go for big part. I mean, I had already amazing parts. I got really lucky. It's like everything is there now.
Mm-hmm.
The chemistry between my even personal life and my art, everything is there. And I feel
ready.
The
tools? You gather the tools, you know the...
It's not. I don't want to feel that I have tools, but I don't. I have my. It's me, the tool. I have my own experience.
Uh-huh.
You're your own master. You're your own. I just feel I have no tool. I could do a scene like this with nothing.
Mm-hmm.
It's just me. I don't need anything. Just a wonderful partner and a director, of course, which is important.
Mm-hmm.
But you're all getting from your partner as well. It's very important. When I was playing with Andy Garcia, actually, or with Christine, we were just looking at each other's eyes and something happened. It's like in life, if you go, I'll look at you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not like alone in my thing, you know?
Right.
So, and as well, the part is so important.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a partition. You need material to be an actress. There's no actress without parts.
So are you behind the curtain of the part, or have you come to the point where you feel you are right sharing those moments with the part?
I'm sharing moments with the part, I think. Very much though. I become the part. I mean, I'm becoming, this is not my words, but I'm like, all my body and what I'm telling it, I'm just into it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really becoming this girl. And I'm doing it with who I am. So another girl who's an actress would do something else.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really trying, inventing things, walking differently, and then doing things with my hand. Things are coming up and it's not forced. It just comes coming from the inside, for something I motivate inside.
So is this something you trained for, or that you just came to?
I did work with an amazing teacher at the Actors Studio called Jack Walser.
Uh-huh.
It's an amazing guy.
So in New York or?
In New York, London, and Paris.
Okay.
He's a great man.
Yeah.
And I still work with him.
So do you, when you take a part, when you get a script like this, do you go and say, you know, work with me in breaking this down and finding those beats?
Yeah, I didn't do
beats,
it with this one because I know exactly the way I should work now.
Right.
So sometimes I go and see him, sometimes I don't. But usually I can do 4 or 5 sessions with them and talking about the part. It's like giving birth. He's helping me to give birth.
Right.
Sometimes you need to find the spine in your character, what affects her. Who is she? In life, you know yourself very well. So you know why you moved looking at an orange, or you know why you move looking at someone.
Right.
So characters, you have to know them very well as well. You have to find the spine. What touches you, what makes you feel, when I was looking at Christine, make it real, always. Why? Understanding why. Nothing is hazard.
So it's something like, I mean, you've played real-life characters, interestingly enough, but not ones that we're necessarily as familiar with. Is something, this is, I guess, French and French, but does something like the Piaf role in last year in Le Mamet, is that a kind of work that appeals to you?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Oh, yeah, I think she was...
I mean, for you as an actress, is that a challenge that is too much of an imitation, or is it too much away from the naturalism that you're...
No, I think she was... You know, she's doing an amazing job.
Yes.
What can I say? I mean,
why am I asking you to criticize Marianne?
Course,
I'm just saying more.
She's fantastic. No, I do feel since the beginning I'm really someone I can change myself. Next year I'm going to play Arletty, who was a very known actress in 1940, 43, 45. So I'm playing Arletty next year.
Mm-hmm.
So then I'll have to dive into. We'll see what we'll do. But no, I think, you know, when I saw Charlize Theron in Monsters, she's just fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
No, I love phenomenal. When you dive into something, after is the director wants to change, some directors say, no, just stay the way you are and just trying to get it. It depends on Olivia Dahl wanted her to change her face totally.
Mm-hmm.
So, no, I admire what she did, of course. You know.
So So you're going to actually, you are going to play a real life French actress?
Yeah, a French actress, 1940, having an affair with a German guy, Aleti Mercure.
So is that a new kind of intimidation for you as an actress? Is that pushing your envelope? Or?
It is. It is an intimidation for me because, you know, she's a very known actress in France. She was talking with a high level voice and very, you know, Parisian kind of style, atmosphere. She's the one who's atmosphere in movie. So it's going to be a challenge, you know. I don't want to imitate her badly. Right. So I'll have to, just going from the inside, still going from her. She's a free woman, very modern. She said, I'm, you know, she said, I'm French, but my ass is international. So that's her who said that. And she was this amazing and free woman. Doing the, and especially talking about artists, ambition of artists. Between, you know, during the war, what their opinion, what do? Do they still go on or do they stop? What's their, it's about that as well.
Right.
Talking about les enfants du paradis, children of paradise. So it will be the children of paradise and then Aleti and the lover, the German guy. So it's a great, you know, fantastic part.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
So there's a community of film in France. I mean, you've dipped into LA and then New York and London. Is there the is there a sense of what that film community is like now? I mean, is there enough work? Is there a sense that it's the same group of people who kind of are working over and over again and a smaller star system than perhaps Hollywood? But
It's tricky because it's very human. It's good, but it's sometimes it's like being friend with who are you friend with and you're working with. So it depends. You know, I got real lucky since all those years getting amazing parts. So since 2 years I've been shooting nonstop. We're lucky, we have amazing directors, good parts, but you know, I'm very exigent, so I want to get, I better have five scenes in a great movie with a good director, instead of, you know, I don't know, working to work. So I'm lucky, I can shows now, so we'll see, you know, there's so many directors I haven't worked with, who I want to work with in France as well, so I trust my destiny, I just always trust my good star.
So at this point, if you, you know, direct, if the right director calls up, I don't know what your list is. What's your list of the great directors you want to work with?
I would say I was very lucky in Australia. I had lunch with Jen Campion, which is just an amazing, fantastic human being. She is maybe someone I'm dying. It's very human for me doing this work.
Right.
The way she was looking at me, the way we had lunch, the way I'm very, might be very too sensitive, but I'm very attached to who I want to stay with for 2 months, who I want to have dinner with. She's really a talented woman and an amazing director. So her, definitely Woody Allen, because I'm a really true, I'm a character for Woody Allen, I know. So I'm a huge fan. I'm dying to work with him. I feel, you know, I was just reading a biography on him, wonderfully done. And I feel like a mix between Mia Farrow and Diane Keaton sometimes. And I did comedies as well, so I don't know, all my neurotic side would be perfect for him. There is P.T. Anderson, which is an amazing director, Boogie Nights, Magnolia, Pendulum Club. For me, you know, it's an amazing director for actors, and it's really someone I would, even, you know, the way he directed Julian Moore, amazing director. Paula Haggis, who I know. I, you know, I love Crash. I think it was a great movie, wonderfully directed. Clint Eastwood, I would say. Million Dollar Baby was still something important for me, having watched this actress.
So yeah, what is it when you watch something like Million Dollar Baby and you go, I want to work with Clint Eastwood on this?
Oh yeah.
Is it because you see the work that Hilary Swank is doing, or that you see what he is interested in about a character, or?
Yeah, I think it's both. I see the way he directed her, and I like the intensity, the modesty of it, the way he's telling the story of this girl, very simply. I like the way, when this character was very attractive, she's like a lonely person, and you get to love her. She is, you know, the way, the compassion, and she's a heroine, finally. She's becoming a heroine.
Right.
He's very gifted at that. and he's close to actors. Even he's in the movie with Tim Robbins and Sean Penn. And he's really close to actors. I do feel always, he loves actors. Mm-hmm. So there's something special about him. Mm. And now I'm with Sam Mendes because I saw Revolution Road and wonderful with actors, amazing. The work he's done with actors is fantastic. And who else? Scorsese. I know he's not, maybe he's better for men, but he's still, you know, I'm still, no, when I'm still, you know, Mean Street is still, in Casino, still amazing movie, and for actors, it's fantastic.
Yeah, he did okay for her in Casino.
I think he did okay for the woman, but he's a fantastic director. His camera's floating, it's so elegant, and he's someone special.
Are you very conscious of that kind of thing on the set? Are you aware of how you're being shot and...
Yeah, I was not, and then it's not especially aware, it's just I know my work now more, so I'm playing, it's always been like a certain, you know, character, the camera, I know when it's there, I learn how to play more, I mean, even if you forget it, I forgot the camera when I'm playing, but it's there, you have, it's like very sensual, in a way. Maybe it's impudique, you say in French. I like the idea that it's grabbing your eyes without you knowing. Sometimes you play a scene, you don't even look at yourself. You don't know what's happening in your head or in your eyes when you play. And I like the idea that they're stealing secrets from your eyes. If they go closer, even little thing that you feel from the inside, it's just magic. And yeah, I like that.
Do you watch dailies?
Never. I hate watching myself. I think I'm terrible. I trust the director 100%.
Do you watch the movies when they're done? Only,
twice.
You watch them twice?
Yeah. Once I'm shocked, and then second, I'm watching the movie.
So you have a ritual about it on some level?
Yeah, the first time they offered me to watch the movie by myself, or with my agent, or with friends, or with my parents. And
a box of Kleenex, even.
Yeah. And this time, for I've lived so long, I cried. It's the first time of my life I've been watching a movie I did and I cried.
But it was the movie, not you.
Oh no, it was not me. It's just, the movie just hooked me. I was so into it, knowing everything, and I was still, you know, fantastically passionate about, I mean, yeah, moved by it. Mm.
So is it interesting going along with a movie like this for so long? And then you've been
It's long, but not long. You know, the movie came out in France in March. It did amazingly well, 1 million admission. Then in England, until July, then summer, then September, I'm still on it, Telluride, then America, all was happening here.
And you had a great time at Telluride.
I had an amazing time in Telluride. I think the best festival in my life. I'm not kidding. You know, talking to people. Mike Lee, for example, is a great guy, great director. You know, we were all talking, and it's a very low-key and lover, you know, movie lovers. People love movies and they're passionate about it, and the audience was fantastic, and people stopping you in the streets talking about movies and crying and being touched, and it's a fantastic place. I think if we would go every year, I would be happy. I'm going to do movies now just to go to Telluride.
Well, you can just get a ticket from Tom and go. Pretty happy to have you there anytime you want to go.
He told me, but I always say I hate to go in places without a movie.
Yeah.
I'm really someone, I don't like to go, I never go to Cannes with nothing, I never go to Berlin. I like to go in festival with something.
I always thought Werner Herzog used to go every year for his birthdays that same weekend.
Oh, really?
So he used to go every single year, and he used to have, I always thought that was why he made a movie every year.
Right.
So he'd have something to show.
Yeah.
Because sometimes he'd show things that never actually got released.
Right.
Always surreal.
But they always say as well, everything that's happening in Telluride will happen. So we're like very into it, saying we're like the good luck thing, a good luck place, and so we'll see. Everybody was, you know, excited about our movie, and it's happening, you know, here. It's fantastic.
So is the feedback you get from the audience, you're outside of a theater in Telluride, or you're at a screening here for SAG NomCom or whatever it might be, does that feedback feel like a separate part of the job, the life of the movie for you, or is that, I mean, was your work done when you were finished on a set, and then... There's this part, or are they all part of the same?
No, it's not part of the same. It's something else after, but it's part of the movie. I've done my work. You saw focus when you do a movie. You go on set every day. It's hard work, and you. I must say, an image would be you're into yourself when you play. You're there, very, you know, concentrated and focused.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing matters when you on set for 9 weeks. You're just there with your whole crew. It's done, and then it's the opposite. Just go, you know, outside, looking at people, hi, smiling, blah. It's the opposite. Mm-hmm. And I like both. It's just my work is to be on set, of course. But, and then after I'm taking every compliment, of course, it's nice, but it's like, you know, everything has to be done again, in a way.
Right.
I'm never taking, you know, things for granted, or as, oh, great. I'm not someone who say, oh, that's fantastic. I'm so happy because my goal is, I must say, is just getting good parts in good movies and work with amazing directors. And then it's still about, I should do it again and again, just to prove to yourself you can do it again. And going, you know, getting bigger parts and stronger parts and complex parts. So it's all about this.
Mm.
Then the others, I'm happy because I've been working for 2 years nonstop, so I'm glad now to get all this compliments. I can breathe a bit, and I'm so happy to be in Hollywood in America, and you know, you have such great directors, and I love to be here, and I really enjoy. So, and it's all what's happening is heaven. It's already great. So,
and you don't seem nearly as shy as when you were 17 years old.
I was. I'm less now, of course.
Well, is it less? I mean, are you over that? Have you come to enjoy the embrace of the crowd and
yeah,
a way
I do.
You never expected to?
Yeah, I do. I know. I love people. I always go. I'm very respectful for, you know, I go to people. I'm very touched when someone, because every movie, every journey for the audience, they have their own story with the movie.
Right.
Or you have a sister, or you, anyway, everybody has his own story. So the only respect I can have, it's not my story. I'm in the movie, I'm playing a part, but it's becoming me for them.
Mm-hmm.
And they really think I've been through that. But they are confessing themselves, saying, oh, you know, I had a sister, oh, my best friend did that.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to be like a shrink suddenly.
Mm-hmm.
You're becoming like an ear for all those people, investing so much and getting involved and identifying with you.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always something weird, you know,
mm-hmm.
but still it's there, but I'm not somewhere else, but you know, it's just incredibly sensitive and special.
Well, it sounds like you'll be able to bring that to your work as you continue on with it too.
You mean bring what to my work?
All these emotional interactions with, you know, people who have stories that are not necessarily your story, but bring you things and you can see the, you know.
I'm stealing everything. Don't worry. I use everything. I'm using everything. Just my life is about that. Even, I'm so crazy sometimes. I think, oh God, I'm going through that in my life. Well, it happens to me that literally I think, okay, that's terrible, but now I can play Crazy Love. Now I can play that. Now I'm ready to go without pushing anything. It's in my eyes. I said, okay, great. This is in me now. I've been through that. It's there.